The heart of your teams. The heart of Michigan. Valley Sports Detroit. The heart of the fan.
Do you remember? Of course you do. Not just the endings, which were spectacular, but the build-up to them.
Larionov and Forsberg away from the play. And now Darren McCarty gets his shots in at Claude Lemieux. And look who came all the way out to try to help. Patrick Roy. Vernon and Roy. How about this?
You remember where you sat to watch the games and with whom you were with? And with whom you couldn't wait to discuss what happened the night before. Hockeytown was a true village then, and when Detroit versus everybody became a collective rally cry.
McCarty draws, McCarty in, McCarty scores! A magnificent goal! Darren McCarty!
It was a gathering of stars here. There were seven Hall of Fame players on the roster. The initial core was Yzerman, and Fedorov, and Lidstrom, and Patisov, and added to the mix, Larionov and Shanahan, and late in the season, Murphy. And of course, that group became special under their Hall of Fame coach, Scotty Bowman, who knew what he had. It was the season when five Russians took the ice at the same time, and the hockey world was agog as we watched them soar as a unit. There was the grind line, which made sure that stars had room and heads were always up. And we had a feeling that after all those years, four decades of them, Detroit might just win a cup again. And then, wow.
3 seconds left, into the zone, to the top.
Teammates are family forever, and this weekend, our heroes gather again, with laugh lines perhaps more pronounced, but with an appreciation for what Detroit has meant to them as well. A very special Red Wings Live on Valley Sports is brought to you tonight by Arby's. There are 30 of them, players and coaches and support staff from that magical season of 97 who have found their way home to the place where dreams were realized. You'll meet them again in moments here. Vladdy and Nick together again at a hockey rink in Detroit. It's the 25th anniversary of the first time the Wings won a cup in 42 years. The conversations coming up are shared between Mike Vernon and Chris Osgood. And you'll hear from Igor Larionov, the professor, about that gathering of players that became the Russian Five in moments. Welcome to Red Wings Live. I'm John Keating. The usual counterparts, Larry Murphy and Chris Osgood, are part of the party tonight. You will see them on the ice in moments. We begin with this, with the architect of the team and a sensational interview between our Mickey Redmond and Scotty Bowman, the legendary coach. And here Scotty talks about finding his way here to Detroit and joining forces with hockey's first family, the Ilitches.
I knew enough about the league that they wanted to win badly. I mean, you know, like Mike had bought the team about 10 years earlier. And you know, Mickey, the story of the Red Wings,
yeah,
trying to get everything going and
right,
giving cars away and not drawing people.
Right.
And then getting Steve Yzerman in the draft and then, you know, getting some other players. They were coming along. Imagine getting Nick Lidstrom and Sergei Fedorov on late picks and Konstantinov. And the team was really coming. It was a good team to go to because the ownership would do anything to win. And I was I was upset at some things in Pittsburgh, what happened to me about my contract. So I decided to do that. That was the best move I ever made.
That conversation between Mick and Scotty is the basis of Wingspan coming up here on Valley Sports Detroit. You'll see more of that conversation on Saturday and on the upcoming days on Red Wings Valley Sports Detroit social media channel. So many great names, all part of the hockey history here.
And the Russian five were really the only, the Russian four for a while. And then Scotty Bowman knew what he wanted. He wanted a final piece to add to that mix. And he had his eyes on Igor Larionov, who was playing for the San Jose Sharks. And he was acquired in the 95-96 season for Ray Shepard. The professor added to what the Red Wings had built here and was a big part of the Wings winning their first cup in 42 years. And the professor visits with our Trevor Thompson in our Coors Light Report. T.
Yeah, John, and Igor Larionov just spent some time addressing the media alongside Scotty Bowman. I'm going to ask him about Scotty in a moment, but Igor, you made the arduous journey over from Russia to be here for only 24 hours. It was a long trip with many connections to be here, but how important for you to be here, be a part of this with your former teammates and celebrate that 25th anniversary of winning the Stanley Cup?
Well, it's a special special day, I guess, for everybody and for myself too, because you can go back 25 years ago when we won the cup, and you can see the crowd, you can see the fans, you can see the city and the state of Michigan behind us. And today, you know, I'm so happy to see the boys, and I guess we're going to celebrate together and kind of maybe some bring some kind of luck to the young team, and a kind of tradition continues in the hockey town, and hopefully the boys who's going to play tonight against Washington, so they. They're going to feed like a little bit of from the old group, from us, and to bring some luck and the success to the hockey town.
Not only the 25th anniversary of winning the Stanley Cup, but the 25th anniversary of Scotty uniting five Russians on the ice together for the Russian five en route to that Stanley Cup. When you look back at that kind of a memory, how special is that for that group?
You know what? It's when you have a chance to play with a group of players from your country and from different generation, obviously Slava, myself, and Sergei Fedorov and Kazi and Vladi, so to us it's a special day in our lives when all five Russians play for Detroit and all five Russians represent the Michigan and Detroit Red Wings in a tremendous success. And to us, it's a special to be part of the success and part of the history, legacy of the hockey town.
Scotty recognized as the greatest coach in NHL history. You had some time to visit with him, but now you're a coach yourself in the KHL. What kind of lessons do you take from Scotty and apply to your own coaching these days?
You know what? It's sometimes when you play for Scotty, when you play for Detroit, so in 8 seasons, you know, he was behind the bench and in the locker room and. It's kind of like go to college, so when you absorb like a lot of stuff from him, and you're trying to be patient with the young guys, you're trying to be patient during the games, and you're trying to play the game with your mind, and also using the right chemistry when a game can be on the line. So that's what I kind of learning from him, and kind of trying to use it now as a coach back home.
Wishing you the same success that he had in the NHL, in the KHL. You're looking great, as are your teammates. Enjoy the next couple of days, Igor. Appreciate the time.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
John, let's go back to you.
All right, Trev, thanks. Unable to make it to Sergei Fedorov and Slava Kozlov and Slava Fetisov. If they're watching across the world, we wish them our best. If you're old enough, you remember all those moments that led up to that incredible night. We'll take you back through them all over the course of the broadcast tonight. The McCarty goal, the lift of the Stanley Cup, 42 years after the last time it had been lifted, and 35 pounds never felt so light. And what do the guys look like now, 25 years later? You'll find out in a moment as they're reintroduced to the Hockeytown faithful on this special night at Little Caesars Arena. The ceremony set to begin, and tonight we remember, along with the Cup champs and with you.
There hadn't been a championship in Detroit since 1955, during the glory years of Gordie Howe and Alex Delvecchio and Ted Lindsay.
When I got traded here in 71, the Red Wings were buried so far down they couldn't see the top.
Seems to me that over the last 5 years, all the excuses have gone away. The players themselves have to shoulder the responsibility of figure out why this team, in these situations, does not rise to the occasion.
And now Darren McCarty gets a shot in the corner. center. Fedorov scores! Sergei Fedorov! Save by Rob Rebound and scores! Steve Yzerman got the rebound! The shot! Yes! Yes! The Wings and the Flyers in a Stanley Cup showdown!
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening and welcome to Little Caesars Arena for this very special evening. In partnership with Meyer tonight, we reunite and celebrate your 1997 Stanley Cup champions. Before we welcome the staff and team to the ice, three special pieces of hardware that will forever hold the legacy of this team. First, awarded to the Western Conference playoff champions, the Clarence S. Campbell Bowl. Awarded the most valuable player for his team during the Stanley Cup playoffs, the Conn Smythe Trophy. With more than a century's worth of hockey history etched into it, ladies and gentlemen, the Stanley Cup! It's time now to welcome the staff and players that lifted that Stanley Cup 25 years ago. Athletic trainer John Horton. Head equipment manager Paul Boyer. Pro Scout Mark Powell. Assistant coach Mike Krzyzewski. Associate coach Barry Smith. Associate coach Dave Lewis. Head coach Scotty Bowman. Assistant General Manager Ken Holland. General Manager and Senior Vice President of Hockey Operations, Jim Devellano. A punishing force whose stabilizing presence solidified the Red Wings' blue line. Defenseman number 3, Bob Rouse. A big, steady, and always reliable defenseman number 4, Jamie Pusher. Seven-time Norris Trophy winner, who would go on to be the captain of your Detroit Red Wings, number 5, Nicklas Lidstrom. A member of the Russian Five and legend throughout the game of hockey, the professor, center number 8, Igor Larionov. The youngest member of the 1997 Red Wings roster at just 20 years old, with speed to burn, number 11 right wing, Matthew Dandino. Goaltender's worst nightmare, the Swedish demolition man, number 96 left winger, Thomas Holmstrom. The honorary 6th member of the Russian Five, number 17, Doug Brown, accompanied by forever our number 16 defenseman, Vladimir Konstantinov. Grinder, an agitator, and a supreme penalty killer. Left winger number 18, Kurt Volpe. The captain of your Stanley Cup champions, number 19, Steve Yzerman. A freight train on skates. He led the Wings in penalty minutes in both the regular season and the playoffs. Right winger number 20, Martin Lapointe. A grinder who scored the cup-clinching goal at Joe Louis Arena. Right winger number 25, Darren McCarty. Bruise brother and a grinder with a punishing right hand. Right winger number 26, Joe Kocher. From Ann Arbor to Hockeytown, whatever he hit, he destroyed it. Defenseman number 27, Aaron Ward. Your Conn Smythe Trophy winner as the playoffs MVP in 1997, goaltender number 29, Mike Vernon. His 317 wins as a Red Wing goalie, ranked second all-time in team history. The Wizard of Oz goaltender number 30, Chris Osgood. A grinder, face-off specialist, a heart and soul Red Wing and Selke Trophy winner, center number 33, Chris Draper. The ultimate team player, as solid and dependable as they come, center number 37, Tim Taylor. A trade deadline acquisition in 1997, he led the team with a plus 16 in the playoffs. Hockey Hall of Famer, defenseman number 55, Larry Murphy. Ladies and gentlemen, your 1997 Stanley Cup champion, Detroit Red Wings. And now, Hockeytown, two others that need no introduction. Your MCs for this evening, Bally Sports Detroit Television play-by-play voice, Ken Daniels, and former Detroit Red Wing great and captain, Mickey Redmond.
Well, thank you very much. As we bring the past into the present, we thank you all very much for being here early in your presence. And again, for this group, another wonderful round of applause for all the wonderful memories. Unbelievable. And while this illustrious group is seated before us, those unable to attend tonight, we should recognize number two, Slava Fetisov. Number 13, Slava Kozlov. Number 28, Thomas Sandstrom. And number 91, Sergei Fedorov. And Mick, when we think back to this 97 team, there are so many memories, and I know you could elaborate on many. But again, once again, that date, March 26th of 97, comes to mind.
We have to remember the Avalanche and the Red Wings had the most talented teams on the planet the last couple of years there. They were full of Hall of Famers. But that night, the Avalanche had the Red Wings number up to that night. And after the brawl, when Mr. McCarty probably should have been thrown out, the Red Wings trailed twice by two goals, came back to tie the game in regulation, and guess who? Number 25 scores in overtime.
And so much of the Red Wings' success obviously began back in 1982 when Mike Ilitch purchased the team. And we're honored to be joined tonight by Marian Ilitch and Chris Ilitch. And it's wonderful how some things just align so fittingly, Mick. On this date, November 3rd, 2003, Mike Ilitch was inducted into the Hockey Hall of Fame in the Builders category.
Yes, he was. And thanks to the Ilitch family, and they were a family, when they made decisions, they were all at the kitchen table. I remember those days. And because of the support that they provided to amateur hockey in Michigan and Detroit especially, and of course, everything this team needed in 1997 to do what they did, we can only thank them from our hearts for what you did, what you gave, and what you provided this team to make a family atmosphere and give us the foundation to have a championship in 1997. Thank you, guys.
And as we celebrate this legendary team throughout the entire evening tonight, it gives me great honor to introduce a man who has his name on the Stanley Cup a remarkable 14 times, a member of the Hockey Hall of Fame, and head coach of your 97 Stanley Cup champions, please welcome Mr. Scotty Bowman.
Thank you, Ken.
Thank you. Well, I feel honored and privileged to come back to Detroit for the second time since I moved. And I can go back to my days as a junior B coach in Montreal, and I was fortunate enough to have a good player. Detroit was interested in him, and a Detroit scout asked me if I wanted to come to Detroit, and I saw the Detroit Red Wings win the Stanley Cup in 1955, beating the Montreal Canadiens. And who would think that 42 years it would take to get that next cup? But here we are to a reunion with all the players and their families. I may mention a few names, and when you do that, you often forget a lot. So I'm just going to start off. I want to thank, firstly, Jim Devellano, who gave me a phone call in the summer of 1993 asking me if I was interested in coming to coach the Detroit Red Wings. And I said, I'd like to think about it. And he said, well, Marian Ilitch and the late Mike Ilitch want to come and pick you up and your family and bring you down and talk to them in Florida. So that was the start of a chance to come to Detroit. I was interested in coming and trying to win a cup. I was signed a 2-year contract, thinking after a lot of stops with St. Louis and then Buffalo, Montreal, and Pittsburgh, and here's the last chance to try to win again. And it starts with the Ilitch family, and I can assure you, you talk about Hall of Fame, and I know that the late Mike is in the Hall of Fame, but the Ilitch family, as an ownership, they started the ball rolling about 10 years earlier. They persevered with a team that they bought, I think, in 1982, and the team was really coming on. I was fortunate to be coming here as the coach, and it wasn't easy, but, you know, when I look back, we certainly disappointed our fans in 1993 with a tough loss to the San Jose Sharks. Unfortunately, Igor Larionov was leading the charge there. And then the next year, you know, in 95, we really got whipped 4 straight by the New Jersey Devils. And then in 96, we were the head-on favorites until we went to Montreal in December, and we slaughtered them 11-2, and we forced the trade, and they traded that darn Patrick Roy to Colorado, and that was probably what they needed. But we gave them a run, and with the help, Jimmy said, we got a staff coming. Kenny Holland was going to come in as assistant manager. The next year, Jimmy Neal came in, and we just went and got players, all of us. We were able to pick up so many players, and a lot of them are in the Hall of Fame. I think there are 9 in the Hall of Fame from that team. And when you think about, you know, the ownership, the players, and it starts with goaltending. Mike Vernon came in, worked with Chris Osgood, and boy, what a job those two did. And then later on, but when you think about the players we added, you know, I don't want to miss any names, but, you know, having all those players come, played like a family. The arena was like a family. We used to just walk around. All the employees felt part of the team. And, I mean, I had the resources as a coach with Dave Lewis and Barry Smith, Mike Krzyzewski in that year, 97. And, you know, it was a dream come true to bring that Stanley Cup back to Detroit. I want to just close with the fact that your team is on the rise. I had the good fortune of watching Steve Yzerman build a Stanley Cup team in Tampa, and it takes time. And I assure them, the fans in Detroit will support this team as they continue their quest for another Stanley Cup. Thank you very much.
Well, you know, Mick, the life of a hockey player, certainly on the ice and off the ice, most importantly on the ice, I guess, is all about timing. Some have great one-timers, but it's all about timing, isn't it?
Well, there was a guy back in 97 and a few years other than that who had perfect timing on the one-timer to start a fight, to finish a fight, whatever it was. He was never late then. He might have made a wrong turn today to get here. Ladies and gentlemen, number 14, Brendan Shanahan.
It's all about the entrance. Way to go, Shanny.
Looks like you can still play today.
Yeah, unbelievable.
Attaboy, Shanny.
Well, this wouldn't be an appropriate reunion without a formal photo op with the banner that was lifted to the iconic Blue Rafters of Joe Louis Arena 25 years ago, along with the hardware that was paraded down Woodward. So at this time, we ask that all of you make your way to my right, where we will once again raise that banner that will forever fly high above Hockeytown.
Once again, your 1997 Stanley Cup champions.
One more time for 97 Stanley Cup champions. Puck drop for tonight's game with the Washington Capitals shortly after 7 o'clock.
Well, it's a little harder to lift the cup for some of these guys these days, but 25 years will do that to you. The smiles as the team picture was taken again said everything. And interesting to note from that team, for all of their greatness, that Red Wings team from 96 to 97, the longest winning streak they had, 3 games. They did it 3 times. They went 8-2-3 in the month of February. And as the guys just talked about on the ice, March 26, 1997, a night we'll remember forever when that team became glued together, fight night at the Joe. Matthew Dandino was the youngest member of the Red Wings that year. He was just 20. Slava Fetisov, the oldest, 38. And both of them played significant roles in the Red Wings winning their first Stanley Cup in 42 years. History for a hockey team and its fan base is everything. And tonight there will be a re-raising of the banner that proclaimed the 96-97 Red Wings as Stanley Cup champs. The man who was the playoff MVP will drop the ceremonial first puck tonight. And that man, Mike Vernon, visits with his goaltending brother, our Chris Osgood, and Trevor Thompson in a moment. And there you see Chris Osgood. There you see Mike Vernon. From those days to these days, backstage before they were introduced to the throng here at Little Caesars Arena tonight. And there is, by the way, a game coming up tonight. The Red Wings of the present day are facing the Capitals of the present day. And anytime the Red Wings score 3 goals or more in a game, you can visit Arby's the following day and receive a free small order of curly fries.
Remember this?
This special Red Wings Live on Valley Sports is brought to you by your local Toyota dealer. Visit buyatoyota.com. Toyota, let's go places. By USA Insulation, your home shouldn't feel as cold as the ice. Stop freezing and start saving with USA Insulation. And by Infusion Associates, providing comfortable IV therapy close to home. Wings of the Capitals coming up. Meanwhile, we look back. The smiles as big now as they were then, 25 years ago, when the group did something truly special, ending the 42-year drought for a cup in Hockeytown. There would be 3 cups in 6 years, an incredible run. But that first one was truly spectacular. And now a unique Xfinity look around the league, because it's a look around the building. This speaks to the true meaning of the evening. The two hockey teams who will play a game tonight have been warming up somewhere else. The warm-up is always to test the ice, to get used to the boards. But tonight, the Wings and the Capitals use the Belfour Training Center adjacent to the main rink here at Little Caesars Arena to get set to play a game. And the game begins just after the top of the hour. It's the Wings and the Caps coming up. But first, more ways to win with FanDuel Sportsbook. You must be 21 and in the state of Michigan to play. The odds are always subject to change. And if you think you have a gambling problem, call 800-270-7117. Consider this tandem. And if you think this will happen, a $100 wager would pay you back $360 that Dylan Larkin and Alex Ovechkin will both have at least 4 shots on goal. The over-under tonight is 3.5. Right now, new customers get a no-sweat first bet up to $1,000. Download the FanDuel Sportsbook app to start making every moment more. What a night, and it shouldn't be a surprise to anyone that Darren McCarty came out of the tunnel with his smartphone in his hand and was taking selfies or video or Facebook Live as he was introduced to the throng here at Little Caesars Arena. There is no one having more fun than Darren McCarty. Might be some having as much, but no one is having more fun than Mac. He's in the glory here with his former teammates. He scored 127 goals in his career, another 23 in the playoffs, but this is the one that is hugged tightly. Let's go back and recall it through GMC ProVision. The Wings led 1-0 at the Joe. There was Konstantinov and Yzerman and Sandstrom battling for the puck. Sandstrom found McCarty at center ice. He pretzeled Yanni Nienava on his way to beating Ron Hextall. And you could hear the roar from Windsor to the UP. The Wings had a 2-goal lead in Game 4 of the Cup Finals. That allowed them to absorb a last-minute Flyers goal to win the cup and end that 42-year drought, and we were dizzy from the spinoramas. There was one, two, and three from Darren McCarty. Well, the show's gone fine, or reasonably fine thus far. That is always subject to change when we bring goalies into the mix. Two of the goalies who are on the ice tonight, who big part of that 97 Stanley Cup champion team, Chris Osgood, and the Conn Smythe winner, Mike Vernon, get a chance to visit now with our Trevor Thompson. T.
Hey, John, and the first question to these goalies is, did you see any of those kinds of moves out of Darren McCarty in practice along the way back in 97? Mike?
Oh, never. Are you kidding? He was more of a dump-and-chase type of hockey player.
Yeah, well, you didn't have to worry about him hitting the net in practice, warming up the glass, so it was a bit of a surprise. But you know what? He was determined, so he tried hard.
Yeah. My Conn Smythe Trophy winner in that season, and just they raise the banner here. They bring the cup back, and I'm just want take us back to that moment when you first raised the cup, what that feeling was like when you see the banner being raised and you're a cup champion, what those feelings are like when you look back 25 years later.
Well, I think first thing comes to mind, though, I was in my net, and the first guy that hugs me was Steve Yzerman, our leader, and then after that, just the rest of the team, and just the celebration that we had that we finally brought the cup to Detroit. So it's always an honor, a privilege to hold that Stanley Cup.
And Ozzie, how about you? The first time you lifted it up, and what that moment was like for you 25 years ago?
A great feeling, and I remember I had a lot of different partners before this guy came, and he was a mentor before to me before I even got a chance to play with him. Growing up in Alberta, watching him play against the Edmonton Oilers, always trying to beat them. They finally did, but to get a chance to play with Vernie, learned so much just watching, just hanging out. Unfortunately, we were roommates on the road. For better or for worse, but learned a ton from this guy watching him play that year, going through the progression of the playoffs, and you're always mad when you don't play, but then you look back and you're like, wow, how great he played. But I really, what stands out to me is how great he played against, head-to-head against Patrick Roy, one of his rivals who he beat in the finals when he was in beat Montreal. So he stepped his game up there, and I thought was the number one reason we beat Colorado that year. So deserving of the Conn Smythe, what a year that was. And then, of course, against Philadelphia, shut the door, and then it was all after that. Vernie never left my house for about 2 weeks.
Well, you were roommates after all, like
well,
you said.
We lived close, yeah. Close enough that we were roommates once again, but not that close, but close enough.
When he talks about that Colorado rivalry, and he talks about Patrick Waugh beating him on the ice, but also beating when he dropped the gloves as well, both you guys had that opportunity. When you look back at those moments, and those are some of the most memorable moments in Red Wing history, what are your thoughts there, Mike?
Well, that just brings out the competitiveness of us too, right? We're competitors, and we'll try to do anything to win. And I mean, I was up against a bigger guy and things like that. But it's like I said before, my brother used to say, if you get in a fight, just keep throwing them and don't stop. And I was never so fatigued in my life after that fight. And then Chris, I was in the dressing room, Chris goes, you've got to go back out there. I go, no. I left the crease. I got in a fight. I have to be kicked out of the game. And no, sure enough, I went back onto the ice, and here's Ozzie going at it, and that's good.
After that, I didn't have to go back in. Yeah, that was a bonus for me. I was in the hot tub / cold tub enjoying whatever I was having and watching us win that game. But again, those are great memories. It's just competitive. What do you say? It's just great to be back.
Right? Yeah, absolutely. That's what makes hockey is so special, and Colorado and the Red Wings, it's great. It's great fun. It was great to be a part of it.
Yeah, and anybody who's been in a hockey fight knows just how tiring it is. How much more of an appreciation do you have for a guy like Darren McCarty or Joey Koser or Bob Probert along the way for the job they did night in, night out?
Yeah, that's a thankless job, that one. I wouldn't want that for all the tea in China, so no thanks.
I think he thinks you're drinking something other than tea. The reunion with all the guys that have come back, was there anybody you were really looking forward to seeing, and just what's it like to be back around the crew again?
Oh, I'm just looking forward to seeing everybody. It's, you know, it's been a long time. I haven't seen or stayed in touch with some of the guys and things like that, so it's just great to reminisce about the stories. And we've been laughing nonstop behind the camera. Oh, yeah. Telling the little stories and things like that, and that's what brings back all these memories and all the fun times we did have.
Well, and it's great seeing these pictures. You know, we haven't aged that much, Vernie. This is a compliment to you for once. But for us, it's like I saw you at Ken Holland's induction into the Hall of Fame. It was the first time I'd seen you for quite some time. I saw you in Calgary. We go through there. And then I was coming to the rink today, and Paul Blair goes to me, the first guy you're going to run into is Vernie. I'm like, not a chance, not in this ring. I'm walking through the Belfort over here. He comes right out of this restroom, a random restroom. I run right into him, of course. So it's like it was meant to be.
Now, you guys, this is happening at Little Caesars Arena, but when you think back to Joe Louis Arena and how special those days were with this whole crew.
This guy that threw the cigar at me on the ice that I was smoking.
Yeah. Oh, really?
Yeah. I got to get that guy's name.
The guy that threw the cigar at you at Joe Louis Arena 25 years ago was standing right here inside the players' lounge.
Tell him to hit it. Yeah, it's unbelievable. You got to hit it.
Got to hit it.
Hit it again. Hit the phone.
His phone went black. We're telling him to hit it again. There's the picture.
That's the cigar.
That's the cigar he threw.
I appreciate that.
How cool is that, Vernie?
Yeah, everybody asked me who threw the cigar. I did not know who it was.
I can't tell.
That might be you. I don't know.
I probably took it from him.
There was one on the ice. There it is.
Well, we did share everything back then.
Which leads me back to my question about Joe Louis Arena and how special those days were, although the ceremony is taking place at Little Caesars Arena. Looking back, how special was that venue for both of you?
Oh, it was a great atmosphere. You know, the fans made it. It sat, 22,000 or something, screaming fans all the time. And it was a fun building to play in. And I played a lot of games in that building, even as a visitor. And I knew I was in for a hell of a game when I came in here. But it was fun, the atmosphere and everything else. You were always pumped up to play.
All right, wait, you guys are going to do this on Saturday. You're here until Sunday. What are you going to do over the next 2 days with this guy?
Well, I'm sure we'll reminisce, tell some stories, have a couple of beers.
Here in Toronto. But he's trying to talk me to sing.
He's
my
not going.
Up in the box, so he's going to go up and convince
Jenna, he's not going.
All the festivities, hopefully. Vernie, like you've always taken care of me, do it again, please.
Yeah. All right.
Good luck with that, and we'll leave it there. John, back to you.
All right, Trevor, the cigar story is absolute goosebumps. That the guy who threw the cigar that Mike Vernon lit up on the ice at Joe Louis Arena just happened to be right in front of him and had the picture. That is terrific stuff. All right, we are coming up to the Wings and the Capitals here, but of course, light the lamp is always a part of what we do, and it works like this. All of us make a selection in a live draft. We can choose a forward if he scores a goal. That's 2 points with a point for an assist. 3 points for a defenseman's goal. Two for a defenseman's assist. You can take the goalie if he comes up with a shutout. That's 5 points. 3 points for one or two goals allowed. And you can take the team, and if the Wings score four goals or more, you get 4 points or more, depending on the goal total. And that's a change this year. All right, Chris Osgood has the first pick of the night. And as he's standing next to Mike Vernon, of course, he's taking the goalie tonight, and that's going to be Billy Husso. Dylan Larkin goes to Trevor Thompson. Mickey Redmond will take Mo Sider. Ken Daniels will take Lucas Raymond, who had two goals the last time the Wings were here. David Braun goes to Larry Murphy. And I'm going to take Philip Hronek. I got a feeling about Hronek getting involved in the power play. Play along with us via Twitter. Use the hashtag I'm with, and then your guy's name, and we'll have final results later tonight. All the players who play the game from the time they were kids wanted to grow up to be Stanley Cup champs. They dreamed of having that moment, of lifting the cup and celebrating with friends, and 25 years later, that celebration is continuing. The dreams of the current Wings and the current Capitals are also a story tonight. Ken and Mick, with their hosting duties behind them, take over next, and Game Time is coming up.
Hey, I'm the heart of the fan.
This is how we roll when there's an honor roll on the big ice. The Red Wings and Capitals took their pregame warm-ups next door at Belfort. With Red Wings hockey, presented by your Southeast Michigan Ford dealers, Detroit and Washington coming up three nights after the Red Wings got buffaloed.
We didn't show up, and they showed up, no matter what level of hockey you play. You don't show up, it's going to be embarrassing, and we got to find it to it, meaning the pride. There's opportunity here. The season's still young. We've showed that we can be a good team. We got guys in here that are, trying to fight for a spot in the lineup. We got guys coming back from injury. We need to show more. We need to show that we care more every night.
Yes, it was 4-3 when Dylan Larkin scored and made it a one-goal game. After that, they went south. This team has given up 20 goals the last four games, Ken. They need to button down the hatches. They're scoring three per game, giving up 3.5 on the season. That's a recipe not to win. That needs to change tonight.
One change tonight for Detroit. Michael Rasmussen, after serving a two-game suspension, is back into the lineup. For the Washington Capitals, there are many who won't be. They have a lengthy injured list. But one guy who will be is Alexander Ovechkin. He keeps climbing a goal list. 399 goals on the road for Ovi. Trails only Wayne Gretzky for most road goals all time by just three.
Is brought to you by Xfinity. Power your home team with gig speed internet from Xfinity. By Femininio Law. Insurance companies say they won't pay. Go to getdavidgetpaid.com. And by Comerica Bank. Raise your expectations of what a bank can be. Come to Comerica.
We're remembering 1997. In the spring of that year, the Wings were doing fine but not great. A trade with Toronto late in that season changed all that. Hall of Famer Larry Murphy, in his own words now, remembers.
When I was traded to Detroit in March...
By Femininio Law. Insurance companies say they won't pay. Go to getdavidgetpaid.com.
Larry Murphy.
When I was traded to Detroit, that spring was magic. Years later, Hockeytown has seen a few banners raised to the rafters, but none higher than the one marking the 1997 Stanley Cup. Detroit became more than just a place I had been traded to. That team, its players, the Joe, and this city. It became my home, and it still is. 25 years later, we all come together one more time to celebrate the day that Hockeytown will remember forever.
Point Farms. Blake and Xander are a great example of what Michigan kids can accomplish when they play hard for 60 minutes each and every day. As we continue this special evening here in Hockeytown, we'd once again like to welcome to the ice two individuals who played a pivotal role in the 1997 Stanley Cup Championship. First, the man that needs no introduction. He's enshrined in the Hockey Hall of Fame for his accomplishments and contributions to the game of hockey. In just his first three seasons as head coach, he led the organization to a 100-point season, a Stanley Cup final, and a Western Conference Finals appearance before finally, in 1997, leading the team here tonight to the organization's first Stanley Cup championship in 42 years. His record of 1,244 wins as a coach still stands today, and a coaching resume that includes 28 playoff appearances and 9 Stanley Cup championships. Next, a Stanley Cup champion goal. Major penalty for fighting. Called upon as the team starter for the 1997 playoffs, he went on to post a 16-4 record with a 1.76 goals against average and was named the Conn Smythe Trophy winner as the most valuable player of the playoffs. Hockeytown, please welcome once again Mr. Scotty Bowman and 1997 Conn Smythe Trophy winner, goaltender Mike Vernon. At this time, we ask that captains Alex Ovechkin and Dylan Larkin join Scotty Bowman and Mike Vernon at center ice for tonight's ceremonial puck drop. one more time, Mr. Scotty Bowman and Mike Vernon.